الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما إنك ولي ذلك والقادر عليه اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم آمين أما بعد. Today we talk about the second hadith in the 40 Nawawi Ahadeeth. There are actually 42, but the book for simplicity is called the 40 Nawawi Ahadeeth. And we talk about the hadith that is rather comprehensive, which establishes our deen, the deen of Islam. In this hadith that is narrated by Abi Hafs Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu arda'ah, he says, بَيْنَمَا نَحْنُ جُلُوسٌ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ As we were sitting in the company of the best of men to ever walk the face of the earth, the number one man, the master of the first and the last, Muhammad صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ إِذْ طَلَعَ عَلَيْنَا رَجُلٌ شَدِيدُ بَيَاضِ الثِّيَابِ شَدِيدُ سَوَادِ الشَّعْرِ A man has appeared upon us, and this man described by Umar radiyallahu arda'ah to be a man who was wearing garments that are intense in their whiteness, and his hair was intense in its darkness. لا يظهر عليه أثر السفر. He did not seem to be a traveler, because traveling back then in the good old days, people did not have cars or airplanes or any of these clean transportation modes, so therefore they either traveling on foot or by way of a dabba, meaning that on a horse or on a donkey or anything like that. Meaning that when they travel through the desert, they are bound to be dirty and dusty and their hair would be, you know, uncombed, so on and so forth. شديد بياض الثياب شديد سواد الشعر لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يعرفه منا أحد It is not apparent that he was traveling and none of us knew him meaning that he's not one of us and he's not a traveler so it's amazing how did this man show up ثم جلس إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم Then he sat in front of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتيه He leaned or put his knees in front of the knees of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ ووضع يديه على فخذيه And he put his hands on his own thighs, not the thighs of the Prophet ﷺ, as some people may understand from the hadith. ثم قال, then he said, أخبرني عن الإيمان. He is now addressing the Prophet ﷺ. And notice the precision of the words. Here the man is asking the Prophet ﷺ to tell him about Iman by way of relating news about Iman. He's not asking him to express an opinion in the deen. He's not asking him, what do you know about Iman? He's asking, أخبرني عن الإيمان by way of that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught you. Means that by way of the wahi. Okay? قال أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقضاء خيره وشره. So he mentions the first aspect of our deen, which is Iman. And just a preemptive, if we were to talk about each and every one of these elements in details, we'll be here for weeks, perhaps months. So we'll talk about it in the collective general sense of the word. At least we have a basic understanding. And later we can build on that in more details, inshallah. He said, أَنْ تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ means that you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You believe in His physical presence. You believe in his physical characteristics as they are mentioned in the Quran, دون تشبيه أو تأويل أو تعطيل, without giving similarities or making parables or giving examples of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may look like, without giving examples of what are the actions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may appear to be or how they are performed, without giving examples about the divine names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as what they may resemble or not resemble, what they may have similarities with from His creation, or contrast with His creation. So therefore, we believe in them the way they are narrated in the Quran and the Sunnah, دون تأويل, without adding interpretations beyond our understanding and beyond what was mentioned in the Quran and the Sunnah. دون تشبيه, without giving examples or making analogies between him and his creation, أو تعطيل, without negating that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, he refers to himself in the Quran as As-Sami'a. He's the all-hearer. We cannot say this is a figure of speech. He does hear and he hears everything. And he hears beyond what we can even imagine. He does see beyond our imagination. How, we don't know. We leave that alone because we've never seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He never described that to us in the Quran or in the Sunnah. So in all matters of ghaib, we stop where the Quran and the Sunnah stopped. Matters of ghaib are matters that we did not witness. Matters that we did not witness. So he said, أَن تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ and his angels, and we believe in all the angels. The number of the angels that are mentioned in the Sunnah is beyond comprehension. Number one, they're not mentioned by number. Number two, they are mentioned by way of description, that there's not a span of four fingers in the heavens or on earth or between the layers of the seven heavens, except that there's an angel in a state of ruku', in a state of sujood, in a state of dhikr, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a state of praising, in a state of hamd, beyond our comprehension. And we believe that they all are purely good. They do not have the capacity to do evil. They are not being tested. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes them for us in the Quran, that they've been created from nur. Nur means light. What type of light? We don't know. It's a matter of ghaib, so we stop there. We do not add any interpretation to it. يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ They fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from above them, and they do exactly as they are commanded. يُسَبِّحُونَ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ لَا يَفْتُرُونَ That they are in a state of tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night. In other words, they do not sleep, they do not marry, they do not eat or drink or tire or any of that. They are in a state of tasbih at all times. لَا يَفْتُرُونَ They never get tired. They never get bored. Some of them, from the moment of their creation, are in a state of sujood. And they raise their heads when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits them to on Judgment Day. And the first thing they would say, سُبْحَانَكَ مَا عَبَدْنَاكَ حَقَّ عِبَادَتِكَ All praise be to you. We have not worshipped you as you ought to be worshipped. We have not worshipped you as you ought to be worshipped. So this is with respect to, in a brief description, this is with respect to believing in the angels of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is not comprehensive by any state of, by any imagination or any form of imagination whatsoever, but rather a brief description of who are the angels and what is our belief when it comes to the angels. I will add just one more piece of information, that disbelieving in one angel alone out of the billions or whatever numbers that they are there is a disbelief of all of the angels, is a disbelief in all of the pillars of Iman, is a disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala negates one's tawheed. The witness here is in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَالَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدُوٌ لِلْكَافِرِينَ It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that passed the judgment upon those who refuse to accept Jibreel as the wahi of the heavens. When the Prophet ﷺ was asked, who delivers the messages to you? He said, it is Jibreel alayhi salam. He said, the Israelites said, we don't like Jibreel, we like Mikael. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوًا لِلَّهِ Whoever is an enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ All of his angels. وَرُسُولِهِ All of his prophets and messengers, or part of them. وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَالَ So even he included Mikael or Mikael alayhi salam, who the Israelites, you know, perceived to be their friend. Said, even if you're an enemy of Mikael or an enemy of Jibreel alayhi salam, that is sufficient to make you an enemy of all of the angels. That's sufficient to negate Iman, Tawheed, you know, from your creed. The third in line is Rusulihi, that we believe in all of the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the rule of thumb is that every messenger is a prophet, but not every prophet is a messenger. And the distinction here is that the messenger comes with a new revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He comes with a message, a new message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They all were men. A prophet follows up on the message of a prior messenger. So he does not come with a new message, but he rather follows up and confirms and propagates the message of the previous messenger. That is the distinction between a messenger and a prophet. And the messengers have a higher status. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked about the number of prophets and messengers, and only 25 of which are mentioned in the Quran by name, when he was asked about them, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent 124,000 prophets, among which 315 in one narration, and 300 and a few tens in another narration that are messengers from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best of these messengers are Ulil Azmi min ar-Rusul, the five mighty prophets that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Nuh, إبراهيم موسى عيسى محمد عليهم الصلاة والسلام أجمعين. And they all are prophets of Islam. They all are prophets in Islam. The 124,000 prophets and messengers, they all propagated the message of Islam, means that the creed that we are talking about, the pillars of Iman that we are addressing right now. So this is with respect to the messenger. So disbelieving in one messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entails one to disbelieve in all of the messengers and negates all the pillars of Iman and negates the concept of Tawheed. Wa kutubihi, we should have mentioned kutubihi before rusulihi, because antumina billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi, so the books come first and then the messengers come after that. We believe in all the divine revelations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent, four of which are mentioned in the Qur'an. Al-Qur'an, Al-Tawrah, Al-Injil, Al-Zabur. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Al-Qur'an, Al-Tawrah, Al-Injil in Surah Al-Imran. When he says to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's the one who descended upon you the Qur'an. وَأَنْزَلَ التَّوْرَاةَ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. Before you, he descended the Torah and the Injil, the Bible, in their authentic form. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَآتَيْنَا دَاوُودَ زَبُورًا. And we have given Dawood a Zabur, a book of guidance, is called Zabur. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions Suhuf Ibrahim, but not by name. As he says, Suhuf Ibrahim wa Musa. So he mentions the books, or the Suhuf, the tablets of Musa alayhi salam, in the generic sense, if you will, and he mentions them by name as Tawrah. But he only mentions the Suhuf of Ibrahim as Suhuf Ibrahim, he does not give it a name. So therefore, we believe in the four names. We believe in Suhuf Ibrahim. We don't know what they're called. And we believe in all the divine books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent over the course of the life of humanity from Adam alayhi salam all the way to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam ajma'in. If we were to negate one letter in any book that's been proven to be authentic from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and of course the only book that is authentic right now is the Quran. Every other book, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, has been adulterated, has been changed, has been added to, has been divided and segmented. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Torah, for example, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِيهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a fact that has taken place over, you know, the course of the sinning of the prophets and the messengers to the Israelites. And he says, woe to those who write the books with their own hands, and they say this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises them twice the punishment. One for writing the books with their own hands and saying that this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, fabricating lies against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And second, because of the benefits they materialize, be it money, status, positions, control, whatever the benefit that they perceive to have materialized by way of falsifying these books, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising them twice the punishment. So we believe that all of the divine revelations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent throughout the history of mankind have been changed, have been adulterated. We don't have any idea about any authentic book aside from the Qur'an. What distinguishes the Qur'an from all prior revelations is that the Qur'an came for all mankind. Just like what distinguishes Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from all the prophets and the messengers, that he was sent to al-thaqalayn. Al-jinn wal-ins. He was sent to the world of jinn, and he was sent to all humanity. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. Say, O mankind, I am the messenger of your Lord to you all. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you but as an act of mercy to all the worlds, to all the worlds. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled the trees and the rocks and the mountains and everything else to be able to listen to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to understand his words. So this is with respect to believing in the divine revelations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now we come to the fifth pillar of Iman, which is believing in al-yawm al-akhir. It's called al-yawm al-akhir because it's the last day. So literally, al-yawm al-akhir is the last day. There is no day that shall come after it. It has, of course, many, many names in the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes it as يوم الندامة, the day of regret. يوم يعض الكافر على يديه, يوم يعض الكافر على يديه يقول يا ليتني اتخذت مع الرسول سبيلا. When the disbeliever would literally bite and eat up their own hands out of regret, saying, I wish I have taken a path up on the straight path with the Prophet. But it's too late. The hypocrites will have their regrets for having concealed harm for the Muslims and for the believers and showed that they're friends and that they're allies and they're with them. The mushrik will have tremendous regrets because they've associated partners with the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everyone who has deviated from the straight path will have regrets. Everyone who has ever committed a sin will have regrets. Of course, for those who did not repent, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to accept repentance from those who repent. Even the Muslim and the mu'min, the believer, the Muslim will have regrets on the Day of Judgment that they have not done more of the good things. They have not prayed more, recited the Quran more, did Qiyam al-Layl more, fasted more, performed the Hajj more, the Umrah, all of the acts of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated and set a fine example for us at the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to follow. Everyone will have regrets because when they see the amount of rewards that they receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for their good deeds, they would wish definitively that they have done more. Even the martyr will have regrets. They would wish that they would go back and be martyred fi sabilillah again and again and again, because of the amount of reward and gratification that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them. And last but not least, belief, or before we move on to last, with respect to believing in the Day of Judgment, there are three elements that we need to understand, which are an integral part of believing in al-yawm al-akhir. Number one, believing in al-ba'ath, that we shall be resurrected. And those who argue like the mushrikeen and the disbelievers, وَقَالُوا أَيْذَا مِتْنَا وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا أَإِنَّا لَمَبْعُوثُونَ. Their claim that is echoed throughout the ayat of the Quran is that they are amazed that if they were to die and their flesh to turn into dust and their bones to become so weak and fragile and hollow, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to be able to recreate them? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses their minds and their intellects, which they're rather superficial, unfortunately, by saying, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِقَادِرٍ عَلَىٰ أَن يَخْلُقَ مِثْلَهُمْ. Do they not see that the heavens and the earth that have been created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a far greater creation than the creation of man, far greater creation, beyond comprehension, قَادِرٌ عَلَىٰ أَن يَخْلُقَ مِثْلَهُمْ, that he's able to create like them and to resurrect them, and many, many other ayat, but in the interest of time, I'll just keep it at that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says another ayah, وَعْدًا عَلَيْنَا إِنَّا كَمَا بَدَأْنَا أَوَّلَ خَلْقٍ نُعِيدُهُ وَعْدًا عَلَيْنَا إِنَّا كُنَّا فَاعِلِينَ. Just like we began the first creation, we shall recreate it. We shall bring it back. And this is, of course, the account of recreation. The ba'ath, the resurrection, is mentioned in details in the Sunnah and in the Quran in many, many places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it is a promise, it's obligatory upon us. He obligates himself to recreate and bring back that original creation. The second element under believing in Judgment Day is reckoning, that we shall all be held accountable for everything that we've done. If it's good, then we'll be rewarded good. If it's bad and we have not repented, we'll be rewarded with that which is equivalent to it. من جاء بالحسنة فله خير منها ومن جاء بالسيئة فلا يجزى الذين عملوا السيئات إلا ما كانوا يعملون. For those who brought forth the good deeds, indeed they shall be reckoned accordingly, and they shall be, you know, given plenty and abundance of حسنات. ومن جاء بالسيئة فلا يجزى الذين عملوا السيئات إلا ما كانوا يعملون. And for those who have committed the سيئات, they will be punished, or the consequences will be proportionate to their sayyat. So the hasanat will be multiplied, the sayyat will be equivalent to the deed. And this is from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third element is that there is eternity of life. There is no death after that. It's either one is going to end up in paradise for eternity, or is going to end up in the hellfire, wal'iyadu billah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Bayyinah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ. Those who believe in these pillars of Iman, a belief that is consistent with the belief of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, they follow that with the pillars of Islam, which comes next in this hadith. عَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, in addition to other good deeds, أُولَٰئِكَ هُمْ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ, these are the best of creation. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the third element to believing in Judgment Day, الجزاء, the reward. جزاؤهم عند ربهم جنات عدن تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها. Their reward in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are, you know, oases in paradise. Sometimes is described as Jannatul Adn, sometimes Jannatul Firdaus, sometimes Jannatul Tajri min tahtiha al-anhar, rivers flow from underneath. And the detailed description of what's in paradise is also in the Quran, but we fail to comprehend because we really lack the mental capacity to understand what is in paradise. When the Prophet ﷺ saw what's in paradise, he described it with these few words. He said, "In it, ma la aynu ra'at. In it, there is that which an eye has never seen. Wa la udhnu sami'at. And an ear of the beautiful sounds has ever heard." Means that none has ever heard anything remotely close to that. These beautiful sounds. وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. And even the imagination of a human being can never reach. Not even the imagination of a human being can ever reach. In it is the best of prize at large. Huh? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٍ. In it, everything they wish for. And before they wish for it, it's present in front of them. وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٍ. And we have more. Means that we have the ultimate prize, which is seeing the blessed face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say the blessed face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, means that the face that is worthy of praise at all times. Meaning that when we see that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that the believers would swear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given them a better reward in paradise like being able to see His blessed face. Like being able to see His blessed face. Vice versa is for the disbelievers, wa'iyadu billah, for the mushrikeen, the hypocrites, the disbelievers, the corrupt. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared, you know, the hellfire for them. In it, of course, there is the worst of punishment. And the worst of punishment is also beyond imagination. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about shajarat al-zakum, a tree that is in the bottom of the hellfire, wa'iyadu billah. In it, or the fruits of which, is the blood and the pus of the, you know, the skin that's melting and the flesh that is melting of the people of the hellfire. That is their food. On top of that, they will drink boiling water that will even tear up their very own stomachs and their own insides. It will remove the skin off of their faces because of the heat. In it, they neither sleep, nor drink, nor eat, nor receive any comfort. Not even a punishment's been reduced for them, not even for one given moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the harshest ayah that talks about the disbelievers and their punishment, He says, فَذُوقُوا فَلَن نَزِيدَكُمْ إِلَّا عَذَابًا. Taste the punishment, you shall not be increased in anything but عذاب, punishment, more punishment, وَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. Until they reach such a level of desperation, they will begin to call upon themselves destruction. But the answer comes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, اخسأوا فيها ولا تكلمون. You shall be despised in it and never speak to us again. It will be sealed with them inside of it for eternity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. The last bit of iman we talk about in this hadith is belief in predestination and preordination. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has knowledge of everything that's going to happen until judgment day. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the pen that was first created to write, He said, "Oh my Lord, what do I write?" Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the pen to write everything that's going to take place until judgment day. Everything that's going to take place until judgment day. This does not interfere with our free will to choose. This does not interfere with the free will of the believer or the Muslim or the kafir, the disbeliever or the hypocrite to choose. It's simply Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows everything. ذلك لتعلموا أن الله على كل شيء قدير وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. So you come to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able over everything. Nothing is beyond His ability. Nothing is beyond His capacity. Nothing is beyond Him at all. وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. And the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompassed all and everything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not cause any injustice to anyone. He simply knows what choices we have available to us and what choices we're going to make. He does not compel us in any form or shape to make one choice or the other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنْكُمْ وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرِ. If you disbelieve, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sufficient. He's not in need of you or your acts of worship. But at the same time, He says in the same ayah, وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرِ. He does not accept that for you. Why? Because it's an act of oppression for yourself and you shall face the consequences. إِن تَكْفُرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَنِيٌّ عَنْكُمْ وَلَا يَرْضَى لِعِبَادِهِ الْكُفْرِ. And if you believe, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you abundantly. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not interfere with our free will, even though our free will is subjected to His will. As He says in the Quran, وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. You cannot execute any order or any action or even make a statement except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here we need to understand the sunan, the guidelines, the rules that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed on earth in order for us to operate within this dunya in ways that please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, Jibreel alayhi salam, just to recap on these pillars of Iman, the first question, which is the question that really matters, and notice it is not arbitrary that Jibreel alayhi salam began with asking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell him about Iman. He asked him this question because Iman is a prerequisite for the acceptance of any deed. So there's no point in asking about Islam and Ihsan if the Iman is not there. Because it's a prerequisite, it's a condition for the acceptance of any deed whatsoever. Without Iman, no deeds are acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the disbelievers. He says, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. Whatever good deeds they've done in this dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it on judgment day. هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا is the particles that you see when a beam of light comes through a window in a dark room. You see that these little particles that you can only see them through a beam of light. This is what هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا means. It means that it doesn't have any weight. It has no weight whatsoever. Why? They don't receive any credit for their good deeds because they didn't have the Iman. They didn't have the Tawheed. They did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not believe in any of the pillars of Iman. They did not believe in anything that is, you know, in accordance with the Quran and the Sunnah. So therefore their deeds have no weight whatsoever. So here Jibreel alayhi salam mentions the first element, which is the most important element, which is Iman, as he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell us what أخبرني عن الإيمان, and the Prophet ﷺ tells him these pillars of Iman in name, because Iman has become to be well explained in the Quran and the Sunnah. So not every time we talk about Iman, we have to talk about everything that surrounds believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything that surrounds believing in the angels and the prophets and the messengers and the divine revelations and the day of judgment and predestination and preordination. So in the collective sense, Iman has become well understood. However, there is a certain threshold in Iman that we cannot fall behind. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained this to us in details in the Quran. And He says, وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذُكِّرَ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِ ثُمَّ أَعْرَضَ عَنْهَا. Who is more of an oppressor to oneself than one is reminded with the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that talk about Tawheed, talk about His divine names and attributes, talk about His creation, talk about His angels, talk about His legislation, His prophets, messengers, so on and so forth. That's all needed of us. We cannot afford not to know this. We cannot afford to fall below this threshold that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has set for us. Iman has come to address the mind. Iman has come to shape our way of thinking, to train us how to think. And just to give an example what that means, the Prophet ﷺ, in spite of his Iman, and in spite of the wahi that he received, and in spite of the wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him, and in spite of the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended upon him, he used to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma la takilni li nafsi tarfat ayn. O Allah, do not leave me to myself, not even for a blink of an eye. So learning how to think is far more important than thinking itself. People think about all sorts of silly things, frivolous things. People think about committing suicide. People think about stealing. People think about doing many evil things. So that's a type of thinking. It's judgment activity. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to learn how to think. And how to think is to think between the parameters of the Quran and the Sunnah. To honor and understand the purpose of the creation of the mind first and foremost. And that is to arrive at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by way of the pillars of Iman, by way of the Quran and the Sunnah, His legislation, and by way of pondering His creation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala oftentimes invites us, you know, to think and ponder in, as He says in the Quran, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَالْفُلْكِ الَّذِي. All of these creations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran in many places, in many ayat, He invites us to think about His creation and the meticulousness of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created simply indicates the majesty and the glory and the power and the status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He says in the Quran, condemning the disbelievers, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They have not appreciated and measured Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and honored Him and praised Him as He ought to have been honored, praised, measured, and appreciated. And that's why they're suffering the consequences. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all of His divine names and attributes to enable us to constantly be present with our tongues and our hearts and our minds, that He's present in our tongues and our minds and our hearts. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His continuous guidance to cause us to live so long that we live on Islam, and to cause us to die so long that at the time of death on the pillars of Iman. Inshallah, you know, this is what I wanted to discuss as part of this hadith, and it's a very long hadith, so it's going to take us maybe two or three sessions to finish it. So in the next session, we'll talk about the second part of our deen, which is the pillars of Islam, and then the third part of our deen, which is Ihsan. And these three components actually addresses the human being in all of his existence. Iman addresses the mind and how to think and how to ponder and how to contemplate and how to believe. Islam addresses the senses, how to purify ourselves, how to purify our body by way of praying and fasting, performing the Hajj, and performing all the physical rituals that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to perform. And Ihsan enriches our soul, the third part of our very existence, which we know very little about, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us this is what enriches the soul, which is Ihsan, the perfection of the deen, the presence in every time we perform a ibadah or we do a deed that is pleased to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to perfect that deed as if we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we cannot achieve that level, not to fall below the level of expectation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees us at all times. And then in the latter part of the hadith, we talk about the Day of Judgment, when Jibreel alayhi salam asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to tell him about the Day of Judgment, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responds by saying, مَنْ مَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. The one who's being asked here has no more knowledge than the one who's asking himself. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew exactly who he was talking to. And then Jibreel alayhi salam asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give him an idea about أمارات الساعة, means that the conditions or the signs that indicate that the hour, the Day of Judgment, the last day, is drawn very close. We'll touch upon that inshallah in next week's session. أقول قولي هذا واستغفره. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك, نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت, نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون, وسلام على المرسلين, والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. جزاكم الله خيرا.